volunteer as tribute.
I believe we have a volunteer.
Welcome everyone to Animal Tales Podcast, episode lucky number 7. I'm Eric Keaton. That's Colleen Cherry.
Hello.
And we are talking about volunteerism here at SPCA Tampa Bay.
Yeah.
And she's in charge of the whole program. And we have a lot of numbers to get to, a lot of thank yous. We're doing this because it is Volunteer Appreciation Week, right?
It is. SPCA Tampa Bay Volunteer Appreciation Week.
I know. You have to follow those weeks. It actually was last week. We did not have a podcast. So we're off a week. But what do our volunteers, what do you have planned for them going on this week?
Oh, yeah. We got a couple different plans. We've sent out some ways for staff and volunteers to show appreciation of the volunteers. So volunteers to appreciate each other. So it's not just me saying thank you over and over again. We have right now around 200 active volunteers between our volunteers here at the shelter, out in the community, and our foster parents. We have just different kind of kudos, handwritten thank you notes that people can write to the volunteers they work with. We have a special luncheon plan to recognize some of our most dedicated volunteers.
Can't wait for that.
Yeah. Catered lunch. Always appreciated. And just little surprises and goodies in the volunteer room each day. That's something different for the folks that come and volunteer with us multiple times a week.
So before we get more into some of the numbers and why and how people can volunteer, let us know a little bit more about Colleen, because you and I we're probably separated joining SPCA Tampa Bay by a few months.
Mm-hmm.
How long you've been with us, and this has been the only role, although the marketing team does stretch her talents very far. I would say a lot.
What are you talking about? The voiceovers and stuff. So I've been with the organization since November of 2019, so about 3.5 years now. And yes, I've always been the volunteer program manager, but occasional on-air host or voiceover talent whenever y'all need me to do that. It's been a wonderful ride. Getting to know all the people who have given back. We have some volunteers that have been with us almost as long as I've been alive. So that's pretty cool.
And people watching this or listening on their favorite podcast provider may go, well, Eric, Colleen already works for SPCA Tampa Bay, but you're like one of our favorite and best volunteers for our department because of the voiceovers. And I'm sure Matt's going to roll in video from the day of giving because this is 2 years in a row. But a little bit about that is because outside of SPCA Tampa Bay, tell us a little bit more about what you do there because, you know, those talents definitely are appreciated here.
Aw, thanks. Yeah, I have a background in theater. My career has been in the arts. I kind of have two careers, my nonprofit career and then my acting career. So I have been acting since I was 4 years old, so not afraid of the stage or the camera or anything like that. So right now I'm working on some shows over at the Straz. I'm an ensemble member with Job Site Theater. We're the resident company at the Straz, so we're working on some musicals right now. We have our own Alice in Wonderland that I wrote some music for and will be performing in the next couple of weeks, and then a musical following that called Lizzie. So do a lot of musical theater, a lot of singing around town, a lot of songwriting. So it's a lot of fun.
And Colleen is also a great philanthropist because wasn't it the 2020 pet walk or 2021 mm-hmm. writing songs and that helped?
Yeah.
Get people to donate. Talk a little bit about that because that was also picked up by Paul Delegato of Fox 13.
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah. I got to write the song for Brody the Weather Dog. So that was fun. That all came from the virtual pet walk because, of course, we all know how 2020 went. So we went virtual that year. And when all of my gigs got canceled outside of work, I had lots of spare time. So started writing songs about pets to get people to donate to my fundraiser. I think it was like a $5 donation and I was writing these full songs. So it was a lot. I think I wrote like 40 something songs in just a few weeks and ended up raising about $1,400 for pet walk that year.
Awesome.
It was my first pet walk, so that was a lot of fun. Didn't have time to do it this year, the songwriting, because I was busy writing a musical, but I still have my little pet songwriting business, so people can request a song and I donate some of the proceeds back to SPCA.
And talk about how you turned our For All language into our jingle.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun. in. Yeah, to having the jingle, just kind of taking the like the language that we have around our for all and our mission and just finding a way to make it rhyme and, you know, bringing it to life through song for ways that we can use.
Very talented. And we were so lucky to have Colleen. And the volunteers are very lucky to have you as well. And one of the reasons we wanted to have a special volunteer podcast is a couple weeks ago, our last two episodes have been about pet walks. So how valuable were these volunteers and what roles did they have for pet walk? Because pet walk could not happen without the volunteers.
Yeah, and especially having two locations this year, we needed to kind of double up our efforts on volunteers. So we had around 80 volunteers came and contributed their time. And that's mostly people who are brand new to us. There's some people who come and volunteer pet walk every year. We had a couple of our regular shelter volunteers, but for the most part, those were all brand new folks. We had a lot of students from SPC's Vet Tech program needing their volunteer hours. So a great way for them to get engaged with us. But just people in the community raising their hands, coming to help out and bring that to life. So helping out with registration, with greeting people, showing them where to go, letting them know the schedule for the day, guiding them along the walk route, which, you know, even though we have those neon signs, people get lost. So it's good to have a human in a neon shirt saying, go this way, and taking photos of the dogs, goats. I don't know if the goat was there this year. I didn't see it.
No, I don't think so. That was the first question I asked because I was at Clearwater. Was the goat there? They're like, no. I'm like, oh, no, wait a minute. Have to back up. All the pet walks start to combine.
Whether the goat was last year.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The goat was not there this year.
Yeah.
Matt,
sadly.
Just let us know.
You probably
heard it through one of our two microphones. The goat confirmed. Was not there. But the greatest all time volunteer program manager is here with us for episode number 7. This week, do you have any special volunteers that you're going to recognize or is it just one big celebration?
It's pretty much a big celebration. Usually at the end of the year, we'll do some special recognition and awards for volunteers where we can look at the hours, like so-and-so is dedicated, you know, 500, 1,000 hours, however many, or special shout-outs for volunteers who've really gone above and beyond. So this week is more about just appreciating all the volunteers and the great work that they do.
What do you think the most asked volunteer role is? Like somebody contacts us, they either go on the website or they get your number. What is the one thing they want to do above all else?
I want to cuddle all the puppies. And then I explain to them, the puppies are usually not super cuddly because they're covered in poop. You don't want to cuddle them. You can bathe the puppies. We need help with that. But usually it's dog walking. That's probably our most needed and our most popular volunteer role. Yeah. Either the cat cuddling, which you can do. You can cuddle those cats all day long, or fostering or dog walking.
Yes. So fostering, though, that is handled through the foster department.
Correct.
And that is a special volunteer role. Mm-hmm. But all of these, is there some type of training or paperwork, background checks, anything that folks who want to volunteer you can help them right now get ready for it.
Yeah, absolutely. So you go to our website, spcatampabay.org. Under Get Involved, you'll see the volunteer page where all of the roles are listed. Usually the time commitments are on there because we have different time commitments. So it's great. Works out with everybody's schedule, kind of depending on when they're available. We have some remote volunteering that people can do, but you can see all of the roles and then the application is on there as well. So we've had to take a little pause from onboarding shelter volunteers just because pet walk,
right.
80 volunteers, got to put my focus there. So we have a little bit of a backlog. There's a little, couple of weeks of a wait before we can get people trained, but we're rolling along.
And they're easily identified when folks come to the shelter looking for an adoption because they have on the light blue, you can see them in the pocket pet area and also the cat area. What are those main roles that those folks are serving?
Yeah, those are our adoption counselors. So yeah, we have that for pocket pets and then for the cats. So they're kind of stationed in those areas and giving support to our adoption staff by, you know, kind of playing matchmaker between the animals and the people, kind of getting a sense of like, what kind of cat are you looking for? Are you looking for a lap cat? Are you looking for a more independent cat? And educating them about responsible pet ownership, because you know we get people coming in wanting to get a rabbit for their small child, and then our Shelly, who is our amazing pocket pet adoption counselor, is very good at educating people and kind of sharing rabbit facts and the best way to give them the best care possible. So it's not like a split second decision for adopters.
We have some videos of Shelly with some of her instruction on our YouTube channel. I would encourage anybody to watch those videos. I think we've made them public. If we haven't, shame on me for not doing that, because I think she does a great job not only for helping folks who are potential adopters, but somebody who may have had their rabbit home for a few weeks and like, I need to get back to the fundamentals. What do I do?
Yeah.
Watch that video by Shelley and they've got it.
Mm-hmm.
And we could see an increase, or I think, and you'll say, Eric, you're crazy. You know, we need to go through the training and everything, but around our clear the shelters period in August, and that is late August. It happens every year with Hill's Pet Nutrition and Univision as well, some of those great sponsors. We have a lot of those volunteers here, and some of them just may be directing traffic.
Mm-hmm.
And we also have volunteers for our team and taking pictures. So how much have you helped our team and working with a lot of folks who are taking pictures for the website? How much have you helped coordinate getting those folks to our team?
Oh, a lot. We've had we have a few volunteers who have been with us before I started as photographers.
Yeah.
But basically all the photos that you see on the website, all the photos that marketing uses on social media, those are taken by volunteer photographers who come in and dedicate their time, get all the photos up on their website and replace the sad intake pictures that they have. So, we just brought on, I think, 4 new photographers just this year. So I helped with coordinating that, finding the people and recruiting them, and then connecting them with Kristen and going from there.
Thank you so much, because I tell you what, that is, and our team does a great job when they do it, but the volunteer photographers, that's skill.
It is. I don't know if you've ever tried to photograph a cat. It's not easy.
Or the pocket pets.
Yeah. You know? And then Julie, who's our longtime pocket pet photographer, she comes in with little costumes and props for them and gets them to look at the camera and pose looking natural wearing a cowboy hat somehow.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
So, folks, I remember when we had Pocket Pet Palooza and we were trying to send a lot of pocket pets home and Matt had them in the video and everything. Cowboy, I'm like, folks, this isn't Photoshopped. They actually were wearing this stuff. Mm-hmm. We're just Photoshopping the video, the rabbit bouncing up and down. But they were actually wearing the hat or the tie. I don't know how she does it.
Yeah,
so let
it's
me.
It's amazing. And then Marilyn is our dog photographer who's been with us a long time. She comes in. If she sees a dog without a photo on the website, she is here in within the hour taking photos.
Yeah.
So they're pretty amazing.
Yeah, they have basically go to one of the adoption areas and set up their entire photography booth. And the rest of us just let them do their thing.
Mm-hmm.
So I copied this off the website. So for folks wondering, you know, they've has somebody that needs some hours, they want to volunteer, mm-hmm. Pocket Pet Adoption Counselor, you mentioned that, animal care and cleaning volunteer.
Mm-hmm. So a lot of people don't like getting their hands dirty, but
that's the one.
That's it.
Dog walker. How many dog walkers do we have right now? Would you say off the top of your head?
I guess. Say between 40 and 50.
Yeah. That was one of the first things I noticed, Colleen, when I got here. You know, they gave you that, I don't know if we do it anymore, the 30-day review.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the one, what did you notice? And I'd been here 2 weeks and I said, wait a minute, all the dog volunteers are walking different dogs. That means they're going home. So, and I thought that was a cool thing because it really didn't dawn on me before. I'm like, oh, check them out. Foster parent, different program.
Mm-hmm. You still apply the same way through the website, but that's Hunter is our foster coordinator.
The best volunteer title on here, cat cuddler.
Cat cuddler. So it's Monday and Tuesday afternoons. Those are the days when we're closed to the public. So in lieu of the adopters coming in and socializing with the cats, we have volunteers who do that to kind of get the cats comfortable.
This is with the marketing team here. We got street team and events volunteer.
Mm-hmm.
And one of those involves going out with us first to learn the marketing lingo and any animal handling we may have. And usually the marketing team is taking very small animals, so they're very easy to handle.
Yeah.
Hardest thing to do is to clean up after them. But it's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
We have a lot of fun at the events.
We
Raise
do.
Games,
mm-hmm.
sometimes some rowdies games. So they're all whiskers at work, sometimes those events as well.
Yeah.
Feline adoption counselor. What about that one?
Kitty cat matchmaking.
Kitty cat.
So that's helping the adoption staff, you know, and making sure people are being safe in the volunteer in the cat room, because you know it's set up with the pods. People are going in, opening doors and letting the cats run free. The volunteers are there to kind of protect the cats, look out for them.
Colleen, have we had many food bank volunteer? Because I think that is mainly handled by our super volunteers of Gail and Nita upstairs. Don't they usually do that?
That is the food bank over at Pasadena.
Oh,
so that's
one.
A new program that we have.
With Emily, yeah. We have that on the podcast. It's different from the one that we have here downstairs.
Okay. So that's staff run for the most part. Sometimes, if a volunteer really wants to come and help with that, we could use the help. But we have that Pasadena food bank, so we're starting to grow more of those offsite programs.
And the last one we have on here currently is the Wildlife Patient Care and Cage Cleaning Baby Orphans. I know a couple of members of our team have volunteered their time to go do that, because that is fun.
Yeah.
It's wildlife.
It is. And you don't have to have wildlife experience to do that. A lot of people are like, I've never done that before, but I volunteered with the wildlife when we had the hurricane and had to evacuate the squirrels, the little baby, all the orphan squirrels, took them in. I'm like, I've never touched a squirrel in my life. Teach me how. And they train you on how to do it, how to feed them, write down the observations. So that's a really popular role, especially with students who are going into the animal welfare field, but maybe haven't had any hands-on wildlife experience.
So when people go to the website here, and of course, one of the big qualifications is must be at least 18 years of age.
Correct.
How do the kids that are in high school try to get some hours here? Can they be accompanied by a parent? Is there any way around that?
I always send some different ideas for students to help us out by either making like enrichment treats or things like that at home, and then they can bring them here to us. And, sometimes we'll take them on a tour and they can distribute them. If there is like a need for like blankets or things like that, making blankets or doing a fundraiser for us. So that's a great way for students to help and support us. But because of the insurance and liability, if they're under 18, we can't have them here, unfortunately. We have been working on a program for students who are 16 and up to help out in adoptions. Started to kind of get that off the ground, but we'll hopefully get that rolling again by the summertime when more students are looking for hours.
Yeah.
Not hands-on with the animals, which I know is what a lot of kids want to
do,
but, helping to help get those animals home.
Well, it's like you said, as soon as they find out you work at SP, do you have any volunteer opportunities? I want to, cuddle with dogs and cats. And it's like 99.9% of the time, what you mentioned earlier is the comment or the request.
Mm-hmm.
And I get it. Who doesn't want to do that?
Yeah.
We want to do that too.
Exactly.
We meant to bring down a puppy that's upstairs and place them in this trophy, which I forgot to remind everybody what that is for, but I will coming up in a little bit during Barking News. Okay. Let me cite some numbers here. If you missed our 2022 Tales of Gratitude, we reported for volunteers 270.
Mm-hmm.
18,614 hours, totaling $560,000, $500,000.
Yep.
That's a lot of money being saved by the SPCA Tampa Bay.
Yeah.
How is that calculated?
So the value of the volunteer dollar, it changes each year. So that number is actually probably going to be higher because we will have more volunteers.
Awesome.
And right now it's about $28. It's 27 something, but about the equivalent of $28 is the value of a volunteer hour. So a lot of people do think like, oh yeah, volunteers, free labor. But these people have all kinds of varied backgrounds and skill sets, and they're pretty amazing donating their time. So it's not just free labor. There are people coming to us
And when they sign up to volunteer with our organization, I mean, it's great. Yeah, we just don't want them to be a number. We want them to have an experience too. How important is that for you to make sure that they just didn't volunteer? And how was your experience? You're getting some feedback for them. So how important is that for you to make sure that they have their experience?
Yeah, I try to get FaceTime with every volunteer when they're onboarded, give them a tour of the shelter when they first come so they know where everything is, even if they're not volunteering in those specific areas. They might someday, and they might even end up working here. We've hired a number of volunteers.
Diana. That's right.
Anita.
Yeah.
so many people on staff, they start out, sometimes that's the first introduction. Stacy, one of our animal welfare managers, she started out as a volunteer before my time, but it's pretty cool. You never quite know where they're going to go. So making sure that they know as much as they can about our mission and how they fit into it and how they can support it is really important.
I think we've told the Todd story before. I think we must have had a staff day or something, and he was with staff in the morning wearing his brown shirt.
Yep.
And then around lunchtime, because he works part-time in facilities, everybody saw him walking the dog in the light blue shirt, and we're like, we can't ask him to do anything anymore, because
exactly.
now he's volunteering.
Yeah, when he got hired, I was like, please tell me that you're going to keep walking dogs, because he's Thursday afternoons. If you're listening to this, we need more help on Thursday afternoons. But he kept on doing it. So yeah, he does that costume change, and he's out of facilities mode and into dog walking mode.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
And before we wrap up, we do want to mention one more area that you are involved with, and mm-hmm. that is WAGS. Talk
yeah.
to us about WAGS.
So that is Women's Annual Giving Society. That is a philanthropy kind of donor and volunteer group. So we have 30-ish members right now, hopefully getting some more after Pet Walk. But that's a group of women who make annual gifts each year, but on top of that also have volunteer hours that they kind of contribute. Because like I said, about the equivalent of $500 of volunteer time they're asked to give,
awesome.
Which is pretty amazing. They help out in many different ways, from doing things at the shelter or events in the community. And then we get together quarterly and have meetings and also do some service projects. So if anyone is interested in joining WAGS, you can join us for our next meeting, which will probably be in late May. We haven't set the date yet, but we'll do another dog wash like we did last year. The women really enjoyed doing that, bathing the dogs, grooming the cats, and having a good time. And then they get to choose a program at the end of the year to fund with their annual gifts and kind of learn more about that the following year.
And they did that last year was Care for Homeless Pets, $16,185.
Yep. So that went to they selected our intake and transfer department to fund. So they've been learning a little bit more about that and getting stories from those departments and getting more involved.
Outstanding. Yeah. Colleen, anything else to add about the volunteer program or our volunteers here on episode number 7?
Our volunteers are amazing. If you see a volunteer, tell them you appreciate them. Not just this week, but every day. We want to make them feel appreciated. And yeah, if you want to volunteer, go to the website, apply, and come join us.
SPCATampabay.org. On the top menu, click on the Get involved. Volunteers will drop right in front of your wonderful eyes. Thank you, Colleen.
Thank you.
All right. Here's some commercials. When we come back, barking news.
Every time you feed your pet Hills, you help feed a shelter pet, which helps make them healthy, happy, and more adoptable, changing their life forever so they can change yours. Science did that.
Who let your dogs out? Who let your dogs out?
Welcome back to Animal Tales, episode number 7. Colleen left, and I have another special guest. It's Pinky. Pinky's being fostered right now. Adoption details will come up later. Go to the website like you want to go to our website when you're thinking about volunteering. How you doing, Pinky? Pinky, ready for barking news? It's like, I don't bark much. I kind of make noises where I sound like a cat. Let's see if we can get through this. Okay, girl?
Reach over here and grab this for you.
All right. Help me read this. Oh, first of all, what am I doing? The trophy. This is from the Salty Sands 5K, 10K. That's right. Maybe we can get a close-up. It's like winning the Stanley Cup. Thank you very much to the St. Pete Rotary. We are the champions. This thing is kind of heavy. We get to keep this. I've been talking about that 5K for the past couple episodes on the Animal Tales podcast. And thank you to all the participants, about 300. And the majority of them said our favorite charity is SPCA Tampa Bay. And Pinky's like, this is not my favorite podcast right now. Hey, another run is coming up. It's the Cinco de Mayo 5K. It's not on Cinco de Mayo. It's actually on May 6th at Madeira Beach. We've had the details before on the podcast. Matt will put those up on the screen, or we'll put them in the description as well. And we also have May 19th. That is the Threshers night at the ball game with the Clearwater Threshers. So make sure you click on the description and get the details either from there or on the screen. That's going to be a night you can bring your dog to the ball game. Going to be a lot of fun. And proceeds, of course, will help SPCA Tampa Bay. What do you think, Pinky? Is that it? Are you glad we have volunteers? I bet you are. That more than $500,000 for our volunteers. That is crazy. We should have brought you on for the whole program. We could have passed you back and forth between Colleen and I. All right, that's going to do it for episode number 7. See, was lucky number 7. We finally got an animal on the Animal Tales podcast to come on throughout the end of the program. My name is Eric Keaton. We'll see you on episode number 8. Thanks for watching and listening on your favorite podcast provider.